But this is awesome. All right, here I am, a daddy. I've given my entire life, and I've raised this boy right. And Brother Paul's there, and I don't remember who else was there. Was you there, Jay? I don't remember. We're on our way to make a teepee. We're hiking over this mountain, and I'm in the back now. I used to be in the front leading and shouting and screaming and hollering, but now I've gone to the back of the line, and I let these new guys, these younger men, take the place I used to in the front. Let them have the experience. Let them lead a while. Let me just stand back there and make sure they're leading in the right direction. That's all. And between me and these four or five missionaries, there's a whole group of pastors, older, younger, a whole, and it's just, look, we're hiking up the trail. Here we go with the smell of the jungle again, the heat. And I'm just sitting back there just weeping because of the sight in front of me. Some of these young men, Indian men, when I got there, they were brand new babies, and now they're men, and they're preaching the gospel with us. They're married and got their little families, and oh, and it's wonderful to walk behind that crowd. And I'm back in the back there. Thank you, Jesus, that I see another generation that can take the reins of the gospel, and I can pass the torch to them and know that it will be kept bright. And I'm just walking back there, just enjoying myself. And I was walking for quite a while, several minutes, probably 30, 40 minutes. And an Indian just blasts out of the jungle. Woof! There he is. How he got by everybody, I couldn't tell you, because they're really good, these guys. And there he was, and he comes running up to me, and he falls on the ground, and I pick him up because I remember what Brother Peter did in the Bible. Do y'all remember what he did? He took no credit for the anointing of God. He said, stand up, I am a man just like you are. Does anybody remember that? So when they try to give you something that's a possession of heaven, do not take it. It's not yours. It's Jesus's. So you stand that man up and you say, thank you. But look up, stand up and look me eye to eye because I'm a man as you are. And he says to me, my mother is dying. Can you please come? And I look at the leader, the Indian leader. This is how he went to me. So I went past him to my son Jody, who is the leader of the section 2, with this Indian leader. He goes, okay. Now this is fixing to get tight, okay? Okay? This is the real thing. This is what we all teach about, what we all know to be true, but we went into the house of a prince of Palate and decapitated him. And it's pretty rough, but that's okay. Can we get gross with it? You know, just tell it like it happened. Okay. I just want to make sure that I don't hurt anybody. So this is tough. Okay. Good. And so, he's not saved. He just heard that we all was coming. And I said to him, okay, look, we'll come. But you got to wait. I got to go preach the gospel first. Remember what we talked the other day? You go. And what you going to do? What are you going to preach? Then you're going to heal the sick. Is that right? Is that how it goes? Is that the order? Yeah. So we're scriptural to say, I will come in a minute, but right now I got to go preach the gospel first. Is this true? Yeah. So we're all under. Y'all didn't forget. That's pretty good. Where did we ever go? Did we ever go to chapter what? Did I say what chapter? Somebody want to pick one? Okay, go to Hebrews 4. Isn't it fun to be free and filled with the Holy Ghost? Isn't it fun? Isn't it fun to go and face principalities and demons and raise the dead and still be free? Isn't it fun to face bullets and to face the enemies of our God and stay free? Isn't it fun to go through the stress and the hurt and all the disappointments and have Christians rip you off and still stay free? Isn't that fun? Yahoo! I wouldn't bore you with such things as how Christians rip you off, because most of you are in such a, I don't know, utopia life right now. You're just kind of floating around. You don't want to hear that. But I can promise you this. I'm a great friend, but I'll make a lot better enemy. Just remember that your whole life. You hear me? Because whenever the enemy of my God shows up, I am a good enemy. I guarantee you, the devil goes down in the name of Jesus. So we're going along. I told him I'll be along directly, but I said, look here, it'd be nice if you'd invite somebody to this party. Those black magic warlocks that cast a spell on your family, would you please invite them along? Would you mind telling them that I cursed their God and he's a wimp? Thank you very much. See you. Where do you come off getting the right to do that? Where do you come off asking me? Just because what you got don't work, don't worry with me. Let me alone. So, we're hiking on in there, and we got there. It was a great service. Remember that, Brother Paul? It was pretty awesome. The Holy Ghost fell on us. Oh, it was wonderful. Went quite a while, and then on the way home, we're going, and now I'm not in the back anymore. I'm not back in the back enjoying the scenery. Now you're going to find out why I have a job. Now I'm in the front. Every available discernment is working. Every available gift is intact, and we're moving with much caution. Could I please make a suggestion to you? I wouldn't frivolously attack a principality if I was you. In the sense of knowing each other for years, me and this prince, in that sense, we're known as, we're friends, but not a friend of the devil, but we're well known to each other. Do you understand what I'm saying? We're well known to each other. Not in a friendship of good, but in a friendship of hate. Because we will beat him in the name of Jesus. And I know him well, and he's not a good thing. He's a devil. And I will, in the name of Jesus, figure out a way to slide that word of the living God, the sword of the Spirit, into that fifth rib and twist it. God will show me how then, before he dies, to take it out and take that head. And then take that head and go to Jerusalem and wonder to the people, why are you such afraid of these giants? They fall like any other one. That's what you have to put up with guys whose names are David. The closer we got, the more we felt. All of a sudden, I feel this wall of energy, and I stopped the guys. It wasn't a good wall. It was a demonic thing. And you could step inside of that wall and out. Men in the crowd begin to cry from the devil's presence. Can you worship Jesus when you're in front of demonic royalty? Is your God big enough? Mine is. Now then, I'm fixing to go into a couple of adjectives that are probably going to be disapproved of, but I'll put up with the problem myself also. I really enjoy being that close to the enemy of God. It's an awesome, horrible feeling, but it really gets me popping. I mean it. I can't tell you how that feels. Every hair on you stands up and the blood is burning through you, blood red. It's hot, boiling in you. Your heart is about to blow through your chest, and it's not because you're in front of your four friends and we're sitting listening to some CD in a controlled environment and getting goosebumps. It's because Jesus in me is greater than he that is in the world. And there's another reason. Hebrews 4:12, the Word of God is alive. I serve a living God. And His name is Jesus. The Word of God is alive. There's not a sword out there sharper. My Bible says the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God, is sharper than any two-edged sword. And it doesn't matter the prince's name that's bearing it. It matters that I stand with it in my hands, gripped, and bow to the King. And He always tells me what? Go.
Preach.
What we're going to preach? Did He say only if the areas cleansed the principalities?
No.
Or did He say simply, go.
Go.
Preach. And tell them the kingdom of heaven is at hand. It wasn't long along the trail we run into some things, these things hanging in the tree. I froze. I'm looking. These things are on me. I can feel it right now. My neck veins are just about to blow. I can feel it. It's wonderful the power of God that can hold a demon prince at bay through men. That's amazing. That is just simply amazing. These great warlords of Satan are standing there, violent and vicious to destroy us. And step after step you walk through their domain. And your body's trembling under the power of the devil. And the power of Jesus in you is holding you strong. And there's these things hanging in the trees. These warlocks came and had filled these trees with fetishes. Who knows what that is? 10 or 15, 20 people in here, that's sin. You need to teach on that. It's just simply a point of contact for the devil. It's nothing more than that. It's a demon. It could be anything. I'm not going to tell you what it is. You'll start doctrines over it. It's all kinds of stuff. We rebuked the devil and kept walking, calling on the blood of Jesus. I turned to these men. I said to them, I said, I hope you're born again. I hope you're not lying to me, because you will die if you're not. Because these boys are not. Never mind. I won't hurt you anymore. I'll use the sword of the Spirit on the devil, not you. And so these these things, we got to the house. The house is covered on north, south, east, and west. It's protected from the powers of any power except the blood of Jesus. And we walk up and these spirits are so intense. Some of the men with me are weeping like children. That doesn't make them weak. That doesn't make them beggarly. That makes them, in my opinion, men of honest integrity. You don't try to suppress or hide nothing in this situation. You're very honest and you're open and you ask for the blood protection of the Holy Ghost. Because my Bible says that the Holy Ghost shed His blood in Acts. It says it. And so I'm sitting there and I walk up there and I'm waiting through protocol. Even through this tense situation, we have protocol. And they said to me, you can come in. And so I stepped inside the door. The lady's laying there on the floor. And I'm observing her, and I'm not paying attention to what's at my right side over here. I'm looking intently on the problem. And just as I take another step, I look to my right. Guess who's standing there? There's two black magic warlock demons. So what do you do? Oh, Brother Hogan, let's share the love of God with them. Okay, I will. After I chop their devil to pieces, I sure will. You're too aggressive for me. I've already told you that. I knew that already. So you leave the woman that's in pain and misery and you go nose to nose to these demons. You walk right over to them and you touch them on the nose with your nose. And you tell them today in their language in Aztec so that everybody can understand. Today the power and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ will defeat your God. And then you step to the next one. And you touch his nose, you tell him the same thing. And then lo and behold, you can't believe what's right over there hanging in the rafters. They brought their God with them. Can you believe it? What an opportunity. Hanging right out of the rafters was a goat head. I said, this is too good to be true. There was things running through me. I was feeling spikes. I was feeling needles. I just couldn't believe it. I almost floated over there to my greatest enemy. And he was exactly hung to my height. And we bumped heads, he and I did. Brother Hogan, you're out of your mind. No, remember, I'm out of yours. Jesus. You better watch it when that starts happening, because devils fly. They're scared of that stuff. So you start worshiping Jesus, devils get freaked out. Jesus, you're awesome. I like it a whole lot. And so, wow, what'd you do, man? The devil was there. Ooh. He's everywhere, man. Where are you going to go hide from him? Jeez. Boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. So you tell him, look, really scripturally ain't a whole lot I can tell you but one thing. The Lord Jesus rebuke you. Ooh, that gets them stoking. So you don't turn your back on your enemy. You back away from him like this, looking at him. You go right down the line in front of your enemies. Just as cautious. Is this not true, Brother Paul? Is this not what happened? Tell them. Oh, we'll get there in a minute. Remember, it happened after. Right after this. You're going to like this. So I walk over there to this grandma, and I kneel down beside her with much respect. She's not the devil, remember? She's in trouble. She has... Now you show the compassion of the cross, not at your enemy. No compromise to the devil. But when you get to the lady that needs Jesus, you take that blanket and you throw it back and you go, whoa. You got a naked grandma laying there. You got sores, humongoid things dripping. Then you got something else. Uh-oh. On every one of her vertebrae down, there's a horn sticking out. Oh, now I lost most of you. Good, good, good. See ya. I reach over there and I grab one of those horns just to see if it wasn't a trick. Surely this is a trick. You know, after all, I am a small bit intelligent. And this is not supposed to happen to humans. So you reach over there. So you grab another one. And them things are attached to that lady. So you look at her and go, man, I'm sorry, Grandma. And then you turn back and look at those devils. And you say it real simple. You shouldn't have ought to have done that. Because greater is he that is in me. Woo! Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Jesus. You see why I like him so much? Because he lets me go into those wonderful situations like that. And he lets me be aggressive and have courage and hold the banner of honor and loyalty and discipline. See, what you do is this. I'll explain what you do. You wait until the situation happens and then you aggressively go after the cross. That's why you lose so many battles. You aggressively go after the cross. And then you get thrown into the situation and the cross responds for you. You have to stay ready. We have probably the greatest fighting force on the planet living in the United States, the Navy SEALs. What if we waited till we were invaded before we prepared them for battle? Of course we'd lose. That's why you lose. We prepare them before battle. We stay in a war alert, and we are left alone. Yahoo. That's why my family and I, and most of these men I work with, we fast every other day of our lives. That's why I get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and seek God for 2-3 hours every day. That's why, because I know I'm not going to have time to tell. Okay, you warlocks, hang out just a few days. I'm going to go home and fast. Oh, excuse me, Prince. You know what I said? Just hang off on that a minute. I need to run home and fast for 10 days. Then you walk over to Grandma and say, you know, I would help you, but I'm not ready. I need to run home and fast for 2 weeks. But what if you believe the Bible and you believe that you have a need to stay ready and stay sharp and stay alert and have that devour the word of life and drink the new wine of God daily. And stay in His great holy presence. And it don't have to be worked up, conjured up, or whatever else y'all do. I don't know what y'all do. Hyped up. You're just ready. All the war buttons are always red. Do it! Okay. But if you are ready, instead of having to get ready, you can kneel down there over Grandma. And you can hug her. And you can tell her, Amanse wala chikawas pan ikuni toteko totiotse. Now the great powers of heaven will come through the Son of the Living God. And you hold her just for a moment, because it's illegal to do that, but nobody will touch me as I'm in that position, you see. And then you simply touch her on the side of the head and begin to thank Jesus for His precious blood. She's not born again. How do I have the right to do that to somebody that's not even born again? Because I wanted to. Because Jesus did half the time the same thing. Half the time it was His faith. The other half the time it was, as your faith is, so be it unto you. And so we laid there and we talked just a little bit, and she told me, thank you, Brother David. See, that's enough for me. I'll go another million miles now. The people I am sent to, that I serve, that I can bring the great powers of God, they look you right in the eyes with weeping and say, Taskamate Nuitni Davi. And you look back and say, Amotleno. Think nothing of it. And then you get up and you salute all the people in the house, including your enemies. And you back out the door. And you tell those boys, listen to me. The devil is on the way. He don't want Grandma no more. He wants me. And see, that's your job, isn't it? The poor, the defenseless, the people that need help. Aren't we strong in the Lord in the strength of Jesus for a reason? Don't we have the protection of the cross and the blood and the Word of God and the angel's protections, the legions of God at our disposal? Don't we have the armor of God? Don't we? Well, use it! The nations of the world are waiting on us to wake up, O church. Arise, O mighty ones of Israel, and let the great powers of God flow through you. Yes, Jesus. And I told those boys, you take off walking right down that trail, you don't look back, you don't answer anybody, you pray in tongues and you worship God and thank Him for the blood of Jesus. And woe unto you fellas that have hidden sin. I'm glad I'm not you. Because the demon is coming. And he's not going to be a headache, he's going to be a prince. And he's coming to kill us. Because the greatest wraths of hell have been invoked now. Because I happen to believe that I have the right to kick the gates off of hell and possess it for my King. Yeah! And so we're walking along and it's tense. Everybody's hairs, people are weeping, and we're walking, we're getting away. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, but no, you're not. But you are. You are. Oh, yes. Please, let it be. Let us get away. So we're hiking. Ain't nobody tired now. We're all flying. Woohoo! We came up to this big wood gate. We opened the wood gate and out flowed the crowd. One minister right after another. Poof, poof, poof. And I'm at the end and I'm looking around. Thank God it's an open field. It's not one of these, you know, dark canopy places. Ooh, scary, you know. It's an open field. You can see. Ah, thank you, Jesus. Shut that gate. I latched it. We're booking. Nobody's allowed to do anything but sing praises to the blood. Isn't that right, Brother Paul? We're only allowed to speak in tongues and thank God for His precious blood, because that's the only thing that can protect you against these principalities. And so we're going, zoom, zoom, zoom. And all of a sudden I started slowing, I heard this noise behind me. Oh no, oh no, oh no, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. The gate that was latched, you can hear it. Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. I turned around. It's standing open with no one there. Then it closes. And I told those guys, come here. Listen. The thing is in the pasture with us. We can't see him, but he can see us. And he's big. And we will win. Now begin to thank heaven for the precious blood of Jesus. Worship the King for the blood of the King. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Help us, Jesus. Help us, Jesus. Help us, Jesus. Oh, God, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Your word is true. Let every man be a liar. You're trembling under the presence of the enemy. The thing came right up to us. You can't see it, but I'm telling you, I hope you never have to feel this. Please, God. That thing was scary. And then all of a sudden, it burst into a ball of fire. And we're all just going, oh, and we're, Jesus. That really is what happened. And so we kept on praying and praying in tongues and praying for the blood of Jesus and thanking Him. Oh, God, you know, it was a perfect sacrifice. Jesus, remember? Help us, Jesus. Please, your flesh is tormented by these. I don't know how many was there, but it was several of them. But this one big one was manifested, and I go, oh, Jesus, because I've seen that thing several times. Jesus, have mercy, oh God, please. Shatane, neakate, Jesus. And y'all should have seen it. The thing exploded. Went over the top of the mountain and was gone. And little by little by little, our emotions and everything about us started calming down, and we began to worship and thank Him and praise Him and honor Him. And the victory finally came into our mouths. And we was just worshiping God and weeping and crying and shouting and jumping and bucking and snorting and running. We was running. That's what happened. But the story is not over there. Because I told everybody, remember, Brother Paul, I said, mark the time. Remember me telling that? I said, mark the time. So we marked the time, all of us did. And so a few days later, I think it was probably 4 or 5 days. I don't remember all that details like that, but too much. But it was a few days later. We was in another village away, a few hours away. And I'm standing there, same old me, just standing there, ready to preach. I have gone. And what am I going to do?
Preach.
What am I going to preach?
Jesus.
You know what? The reason I can do that is because it says in my Bible, I read a verse, a new one. I got one for you. Ready? It's in Matthew 21, verse 21. It's brand new today. I found it myself in the Bible. It says, all things whatsoever you ask in prayer, believing, you shall receive. Isn't that something? Yahoo! And y'all listen to me. I'm standing there, service is fixing to start, and all of a sudden you see in the darkness, here comes this little crowd of people. They're coming out of the darkness through the jungle, and you're looking at them, you know, I wonder who they are. Zoop! They walk right up to me. I'm looking at them, and I'm backing up from them. I wonder who these people are, watching for guns and knives and all that kind of stuff. This little old grandma, she's standing right straight, looking at me, just flat, feet stable, and looking me right in the face, which is unusual for women. They don't do that. And she says to me, thank you, Brother David. And I back off from her. Where do I know you from? She said, you came to my house not long ago. I said, I ain't so. She said, oh, yeah. She said, I was a little grandma what had the horns. I said, what time did Jesus come in your house? She told me it was the moment that thing blew up. The Holy Ghost hit her. Those horns and those sores are gone. Jesus. Yeah. Jesus. There were 11 people with her, and they all got born again. Isn't that something? Isn't that awesome? Isn't that wonderful? Wow. What a God. I'm going to read this verse with you. I'm going to stop. And then we're going to trust Jesus for touching us, okay? Mark. Y'all, I can honestly tell you that I feel the presence of Jesus, and it's wonderful. It's awesome. But I can also tell you that I felt the presence of Jesus under the thumb of one of the greater princes I've ever had to fight against. I can also tell you I feel the presence of the Lord Jesus when they got their big guns on us. Circumstances has nothing to do with my emotions. My emotions do not run my circumstances, nor do my emotions run the Holy Ghost in me. I am filled with the Holy Ghost because the Bible says I am. It doesn't say if everything's pretty and I like it. It says that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. It says, for this purpose was the Son of God manifested to destroy the works of the devil. It says, greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. It says, go, preach the gospel to every creature. Okay, I think I will. I want to read this with you, please. Mark chapter 16. I tell you, I found this morning. I couldn't believe it was in the Bible. You know that song?
Tic Tacs, cinnamon. They taste good. It says right here in my Bible,
oh no, I don't want to read this to you. It is so wonderful. I found it this morning, and I want you to believe it like I do. I want you to appreciate it like it's supposed to be. I want me to bow to it greater also. I do. I want us to do that. Please, would you just at least consider that? Please. Oh God, here we go. Mark 16. Uh-oh. Verse 10. Oh boy. The Bible says, my Bible says, she went and told them that she had been with Jesus. I've done my best. I've come here and I've told you I walk with Jesus. I've done the same thing that this lady's done. I've come. I've been with Jesus. I hear you weep. I hear you mourn. Just like these people. He is not dead. He is alive. Uh-oh, I'm going to get you and you're going to get mad, but I can live with that. Starting around this time of the year called Shantolo, where I come from, is where they all dress up like women and have these massive orgies and these dead people come back and everybody has sex with them and so forth and so on. It's when y'all begin to bow to those pagan demons also. And then you take Jesus, the great King of the universe, and you shrink him to this little bitty thing and you stick him in some little hay thing. I guess I better just inform y'all. He ain't in that stupid box. I'll tell you one more thing I guess I better inform y'all of. Some of y'all walk around, you got these things around your neck, I've seen them. And it's made out of these gold or silver crosses, and you got him hanging there. Listen to me. I have to tell you something. He ain't hanging on that cross anymore. My Bible says he has ascended and sits triumphant over death, hell, and the grave. And he continually makes intercession for you and I. Wow. Jesus loves me. He's interceding to the Father for me. Ooh. Let's go far. What you say? Come on. Quit your weeping and mourning. You're not defeated. You are victorious. I understand the temptation. It's not that I can't see the problem. The problem is not God. Jesus is Lord. Okay? And it says right here in my Bible, it says, and they, when they had heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, comma, what'd they do? They didn't believe. Many of you in here don't believe me what I'm saying. And I'm sorry for that. That's not my problem. That's yours. Because it's true. There's many, many more things to talk about it. Some things can't be shared with you. You won't listen. After that, he appeared to some more people. Verse 12. And they went and told the residue in verse 13. But neither believed they them. There's going to be many people come like me. Some of you will believe. Some of you will become like me and other men that are doing something for heaven. Some of you really will, but the majority of you will stay mundane and get mad. It's not my fault, neither is it heaven's fault. It's your choice. And I expect you to take the responsibility for that.
and make a decision. I was taught by one of the best, Brother T.L. Osborne. He said, every time you preach, make sure that every time you preach, people you're speaking to make a decision. And so it says right here in my Bible, it says, afterwards he appeared to the 11 as he sat and meat. What did he do to him? What was his... Look, you got to understand. Don't you understand what happened to him? He was raised from the dead. He showed himself to people. He sent his messengers before his face, and people still didn't believe. So what was his message when he come back? I love you, boys. I understand. That's not what he said. My Bible says he upbraided them and rebuked them for their hardness of heart and unbelief. Whoops. Well, that's what the Bible says anyhow. It says, and he said to him, uh-oh, here's the go word again. Can you believe it? Why don't he say, just sit for a few minutes? But his first words are, go! Oh! But I have to report to you that I am not an explainer, just a reporter. And I didn't write the Bible, the Holy Ghost did. All I do is read it. And do it. Okay, is that fair enough? It says here in the Bible, in my Bible, it says, go and preach the go around the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believes, that's the first thing that's got to happen. And is baptized, that's the second thing, it can be saved. And, but he that believes not, you're a damned individual. Now then, I'm going to have to rebuke you just lightly, okay? Is that okay? It may get a little serious, but probably not. These signs shall follow them that believe. One of the main questions asked to me as I go around the whole world is, how in the world do you get those things to happen for you? I believe. Well, why don't they happen? Why can't I have it? You don't believe. I didn't write it. I just read it and believe it. And these signs shall follow them that believe in my name. They shall do a whole bunch of things. I ain't going to go through it all. Boy, I really could. It'd be fun. Cast out devils, speak new tongues, take up serpents, drink deadly things. They won't hurt you. Lay hands on the sick and they go on to recover. So then after he spoke to them, he was received up into heaven. He sat at the right hand of God Almighty. In verse 20, you must see this. As soon as he told it to them, what did they do? Well, I'll be, can you believe that? They did what he said. And they went forth. And preached where? Everywhere. And when they did what he said, it's kind of like if we was reading Matthew chapter 10 again, isn't it? They went, they preached, something happened. The Lord was with them, confirming their word. Wow. So I suggest we take it at what it says and let's go and do it. Is that all right with you? Can we do that? Would you please stand up and let's pray together?